Hi guys, thanks for tuning in to another video on ForgottenWeapons.com. I'm Ian McCollum, and today we're going to talk about the history of another major American gun company. Specifically today, we're going to be looking at Springfield Armory. Now there is a Springfield Armory Incorporated company, it exists right now, they make a bunch of different guns, you've almost certainly heard of a bunch of them. Go to their website. There was also a Springfield Armory established even while the Revolutionary War was still underway. And they're not exactly the same thing. So let's take a look at where Springfield Armory originated and what happened to it over time. The beginning was in 1777 when George Washington himself personally approved the location for the Springfield Armory in the town of, you guessed it, Springfield, Massachusetts. That's southern, pretty much central, maybe a little bit western Massachusetts. And that location was chosen not because it was a thriving industrial area. It wasn't. Springfield was actually a pretty darn small little town at that time. But it was an excellent geographic location. Springfield was located on the confluence of three separate rivers, and the water was useful for both power. This would become critical to the armory's operations when they started making firearms, and also for transportation. And in addition to the three rivers, there were also four main roads that intersected in Springfield, allowing easy access to four of the main cities in New England at the time. So, great place to put an arms depot. And that's what this was. They didn't start making guns there until the 1790s. Starting in 1777, it was an arms repository, and they had some workshops there that did work other than actually making firearms. So they did things like carriages for artillery pieces. They stored firearms. They stored ammunition. It was a depot. It was enough of a depot, actually, that in 1787, it attracted the attention of Daniel Shays. Shays' Rebellion, which if you're not familiar with, you should go look up and learn about. Shays' Rebellion was actually put down with force at Springfield Armory when the rebellious farmers attempted to sack the armory to get the guns. And then, really, the next major event in Springfield's history was 1794 to 95, when construction was completed on actual firearms manufacturing facilities. And in 1795, Springfield Armory started making its first firearms. In that year, they had a total of 40 employees, and they manufactured 245 muskets. Not exactly a huge industrial operation, but this was the beginning. And remember, in 1795, the United States was a very young country and was just starting to get some of its own infrastructure in place for things like national manufacture of military arms. Now, just a few years later, in the 1790s, Congress would establish a second national armory at Harper's Ferry, Virginia. That one would never quite have the same significance as Springfield, and Harper's Ferry, being located in what would become the Confederacy, did not survive the Civil War. At the beginning of the Civil War, the staff there attempted to destroy it. They didn't really manage to destroy all the machinery, but the Harper's Ferry Armory would never come back after the Civil War. And at that point, that left Springfield Armory as the single primary U.S. national armory. They would open up the Rock Island Armory as well, but Rock Island, like Harper's Ferry, never had the significance of Springfield. Springfield would become a center of industrial production. It would become a center of arms design and research, as well as full-fledged fabrication. So the Springfield Armory, once it was up and running in the 1800s, manufactured guns completely from scratch. They had many acres of shops and machinery. I mentioned earlier the rivers in Springfield. The armory would build what it called the water shops, which used the rivers for hydraulic power to turn water wheels before the use of electricity or combustion engines, and that provided the power to run the machine tools in the armory. Many of the iconic firearms of the American military had their origins in Springfield Armory. The trapdoor Springfield was designed by a man who was at the time superintendent of Springfield. The 1903 Springfield rifle was designed in the Springfield Armory. The M1 Garand rifle was designed by John Garand over the course of many years while he was working as an employee of the Springfield Armory. This really was, in a way, this is something that many European countries have or had. A single government-funded national armory whose job was to provide arms for the military. And this has been, well, I'm getting ahead of myself. Springfield Armory became quite the huge operation. By World War II, they had something like 15,000 employees. They were manufacturing massive numbers of firearms. You'll find, like I was just talking about, all of these firearms manufactured by the Springfield Armory. They did also contract out to other commercial companies. The idea with Springfield was that it provided a central hub. Springfield could figure out the initial production. They could work out the kinks in a firearm's design before subcontracting it out to commercial manufacturers. So things like designing jigs and fixtures and tooling and developing the process of manufacturing. You know, if we want to make this complex part, like an M1 Garand Oprod, how do we do it? What tools do we use? What order do we make all of the cuts in the material to go from a block of steel to a finished operating rod? The Springfield Armory could figure all of that out. And what that meant is once they were completed and once they were ready to hand off production to a commercial enterprise, presumably because the military needed a larger quantity of guns than the armory itself could provide, once that process was ready, things would go nice and smoothly. And the armory was funded during war and peace. Obviously, its employment fluctuated as necessary, but the idea was to maintain this base of skilled technicians and workers so that at any point that the nation needed to tool up and arm a large number of soldiers, that could be done. It had the basic competence to do that in the armory. And you'll find this, like I said, in a bunch of other European countries that had their own national armories. Now, after World War II, of course, the armory started to scale down its operations. It had needed to produce a lot during World War II and not so much afterwards. We had plenty of guns for quite some time. And in the 1960s, Robert McNamara, as Secretary of Defense, decided that the armory was an obsolete concept. It was no longer needed. And he thought it would be more economical and more efficient to rely entirely on private industry to do the design and the production and the R&D and the tooling and everything. The government, instead of having to maintain this armory all the time, whether it was needed at the moment or not, instead, they could rely on a commercial, well, many commercial gun companies to stay in business and provide the government with arms when necessary for war. So the shutdown of Springfield Armory was kind of a slow process. By 1968, it was complete and the armory was finally closed. At that point, when it shut down, it only had about 100 workers left because they had been slowly reducing operations. The armory itself at that point, or by today, has become a property of the National Park Service and is a historic landmark for the United States, but it's gone completely. Its production capability disappeared, and as McNamara planned, the United States would go on to being dependent on commercial companies for its arms design, the next obvious one being the AR-15, which was designed by Armalite and then manufactured by Armalite and by Colt. On the commercial level, supplied by contract to the military. Now, there is a debate that can be had over the pros and cons of this decision, whether it's better for the state to maintain an arsenal and pay for it, and also that means being able to dictate exactly what the government wants to manufacture at any given time, instead of being dependent on convincing private companies that it might be worth their while to develop specific individual firearms. But we'll bypass that. So 1968, the Springfield Armory shuts down in Massachusetts, and it is no more. Only a couple years would elapse before a man named Elmer Balance registered Springfield Armory as a trademark in 1971. Mr. Balance ran a company called the LH Gun Company in Divine, Texas, and he had come up with the idea to manufacture a commercial version of the M14 rifle. He called it the M1A, and I'm sure you're very familiar with it today. Now, he did this using a lot of surplus M14 parts and then casting or subcontracting the casting of receivers specifically for civilian semi-automatic only copies, the M1A. He did this for a couple years, and then my understanding is got into some tax or financial problems, and he ended up selling the whole enterprise, the tooling and the trademarks, to a family by the name of Reese in Geneseo, Illinois. And the company moved, so it had begun in Divine, Texas, it moved to Geneseo, and there it actually remains to this day. Now, what Balance had done was trademark the name so that he could use it commercially. And he was making a firearm that was similar to something that Springfield had made at one point, but never, there was really no further connection between the two. What this was an attempt to maintain the brand awareness of a massively long-lived American institution and transfer its value onto a new production firearm. And that's what Springfield still does today. So they used to have in their logo since 1794, which was, I think, a little disingenuous. They have gotten rid of that since, so I can't really hold that against them. But Springfield today is an entirely commercial company with no direct ties to the original actual armory. That said, they do make a wide variety of firearms, and they've been doing so for nearly 50 years now, 45 years, 40 years, something along those lines. And they've done a wide variety of guns. Now, the difference here is Springfield Armory as a company doesn't do the same thing that Springfield Armory as a national armory did. Springfield Armory, the company, Springfield Armory Inc., does a lot of subcontracting. And one of the keystone features of the actual National Armory was that it provided virtually everything in-house. And by the way, in the process, it contributed a lot of innovative engineering and industrial developments to the country. I should have mentioned this earlier, but things like the Blanchard lathe, which was a very early machine used at the armory for stock duplicating, but it was this ingenious device where you could put any sort of odd-shaped piece of wood or metal in one side and a solid blank of wood on the other side, and the machine would copy in three dimensions your original onto your new stock. Really quite an innovative piece of machinery and just one of many things that was developed by the National Armory. At any rate, Springfield Armory Inc., like most gun companies today, subcontracts most of its parts out to other establishments. They do a lot of their assembly in-house, but they bring in parts for their guns from many other places, both in the US and internationally. In addition to that, one of the cool things that Springfield did was for a long time, they would import guns from a variety of international sources. So before the assault weapons ban in the 1990s, Springfield Armory was an importer of Greek G3 rifles. You'll find those as the SAR-3 and the SAR-8 on the used market. They imported FALs from Imbel in Brazil. You'll find those as the SAR-48, SAR, Springfield Armory, and the SAR-4800 after the establishment of the assault weapons ban. They had a scheme at one point to import Astra pistols that kind of fell through. One of their landmark products still today is the Springfield XD. That is actually the Croatian HS2000 imported and rebranded. The cornerstone of their business is, or for a long time was, the 1911 and the M1A. They do still continue to offer those, and those are partially made in the US and partially made from outsourced parts as well. That is the history of Springfield Armory in its two main guises. I think it's important to call out the difference between what was a fundamental institution of the American military system, the Springfield Armory in Springfield, Massachusetts, versus Springfield Armory Incorporated, the gun company that exists today. Thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed the video. We will be back again at some point with another installment in this series looking at the history of not just American, but we're also going to get into a number of international or European, Asian firearms manufacturers.